We can get started.
Come take a seat anywhere. There's plenty of seats up here.
Maybe this one here in the middle will have to be our overflow table. There's some people that have meetings going to 4:30 or coming a little late or something like that. And a few of you can't stay for dinner, so we also want to make use of this next hour. So, so welcome. I'm Brian Stilner, co-director this year of the Hersher Institute for Applied Ethics, along with Francis Krasinski. Our colleague Mike Venemilia is on, lucky to be on a full-year sabbatical this year. So. He would have loved to have been here and had the idea for bringing Jim Keenan, partly, who's been a guest of this university, but it's been a while since he's spoken here, but back in the 2000s and 1990s, he came some different times for some of our pastoral education institutes. Once when he came, I remember we had him do also a round table for the Hersher Institute. So we're welcoming him back to our campus, but he got to see the chapel today for the first time, for instance. We talked about everyone introducing themselves briefly?
Yeah.
Do you want to just shout out from at your place?
Yeah, just shout out at your place who you are.
Jim Coughlin from BC.
Tony Ciara, friend of mine here from BC.
Jim Barconero.
Hi, Robin Cook.
Jerry Reed.
Marianne Davidson.
Mary Lou Seifert.
Robbie Dangro. Yeah.
I think we've got it almost right. So,
where we go?
Sorry, Eric.
Eric Hammack.
Okay.
And you didn't all say where you're from, but we have full-time faculty, part-time faculty. We have faculty from all of our colleges and schools, just about. We're having more schools developing, yes. Dom Pinto from the new School of Computer Science had a death in the family, so he couldn't be here. A few people have fallen ill and can't be here. We have campus ministry, mission, service learning. We have administrators. Most or all of our deans are here. We have our provost, Rupendra, and I think President Patillo is coming later as well. So it fits with the theme of tonight, which is really to talk about university ethics, which all universities take seriously a name, and most want to indeed, but the theme of the book is we could always be doing better, and it really involves, it starts with, as John Till has talked about a lot, breaking down silos, communicating, knowing what's going on with each other. So it's really about fostering conversation, and this book, written by Jim Keenan, is, as you saw, you've all read it, and I think most of you read all of it, which is great, and I've heard a lot of good feedback about it, so I know I don't want to go on too long with an introduction and really get to the substance of it. We're going to start tonight with him telling us a little bit about why he, as a professor of Catholic and Christian ethics and a longtime academic, came to this topic, why he wrote the book, what kind of reception he's been getting. Then we're going to have a couple responses from a few people in the room kind of representing a couple different institutional roles at our university and at a university. And then he'll do a little response and we'll then have open conversation and comments. And hopefully during the dinner too, I figured maybe one part of our convivial discussion could be a little bit of further talking about what this might mean for Sacred Heart and what we might want to do afterward, and maybe then at the end with dessert and coffee we could share if there are a few other ideas to wrap up. In the interest of a very short introduction, I think like in the back flap of the book you can tell a little bit about Jim Keenan. He's taught at Boston College and the Western Jesuit School of Theology for 15-20 years, that kind of area. When I was coming into my field of Christian ethics, and going to the Society of Christian Ethics in the late 1990s as I was just coming out of grad school, he was already a kind of respected mid-level person in our field, and I just remember from my earliest years hearing very welcomed by him, and he's really about bringing people together and conversations together, and ideas together. You can see that in the book. He's not only written several of his own books, but also edited books that bring, for instance, he brought in the early 2000s a lot of Catholic theologians worldwide together to talk about what is the challenge of HIV/AIDS mean for Catholic theology institutions, a book that I taught in my bioethics class for, back in that time. And he's also organized a couple of international conferences. We've been part of several people organizing international conferences of Catholic ethicists to really be aware as a worldwide academic body and a worldwide church of what we can learn from each other. So those are just a few of the ways that he's sort of impacted me as an academic and a teacher. So I think without further ado, I will turn it over to Jim.
So it's very, I'm really grateful that you're here. I'm looking forward to your comments, so I'm going to try to be brief. First, the accent. I'm a New Yorker. I'm the son of a cop. My father was head of Manhattan South Homicide Squad. Those of you who are my age know Kojak. I'm the son of Kojak. I knew what a perpetrator was at 4 years of age. But I say that because I found myself in about the year 1995 teaching in Boston. And by the break of the sex abuse scandal, I was a priest teaching moral theology in Boston. And I found myself involved in the sex abuse scandal in a way like, how did this happen? And my questions were basically, what was the formation of priests and bishops in terms of a professional responsibility? Where were the questions about how people handled these accusations that were going on? How did they relate and respond on matters of transparency? What type of accountability? And I began asking questions of the church, what type of real formation do we have going on professional formation of the church as an institution that teaches ethics to everyone but itself? That naturally led me, by the end of the sex abuse scandal, to think about the university. And I began to look at one thing, item in the news after another, saying to myself, this happened at a university. I also live in a Jesuit community that has David Hollenbach in it, who's a social ethicist. John Paris is a medical ethicist. Andrea Vicini, who's a bioethicist. A Franciscan named Ken Hines, who's in War and Peace. And I told them that I wanted to look to say, are these issues happening at universities because it's a university, or are they just incidental to it? And they ended up reading the newspapers with great interest on my project, so that every morning when I'd come down for breakfast, they'd say, Jimmy, did you see about UNC? They had courses there for their football team that were fictive. Did you see about Penn State? Did you see about the death at Florida A&M? Did you see, and each morning, they would greet me with the scandal of the day. That just happened to be at a university, and no one acknowledged that perhaps the university wasn't doing much on ethics. And that's how the project began, and I started working on it. Since the book had came out in last May, I get invited to different places. Fairfield, they had the entire administration read the book and do a seminar like here, and then I came to it at the end. I've done it with St. Thomas University. I just did a series of lectures with the Association of Catholic Colleges and Universities, all the CAOs there, speaking to them about the book. Down in Puerto Rico, I was invited to address three different universities in San Juan last month. The superintendent of West Point wrote how much he liked the book and how he bought 15 copies for his staff. So it's very interesting to see how different pockets of a university receive it. And this is really great because it's so diverse. It's so diverse. And I think that helps, because sometimes I'm just talking to adjunct faculty, or I'm just talking to administrators, or I'm talking to people in student affairs, but they're not connected. This is an experience of being connected. So I'm just going to close. I put on your tables this. We're having a conference at Boston College that you can register for. It's free registration, but that's the only way you can come if you're registered. It's April 5th to the 7th. It's a conference about connecting the dots. We have major speakers coming who all do work on one particular thing, like Taylor Branch did university sports. Ruth Simmons is the first African-American to be president of an Ivy. She's doing race and gender. But we have somebody who's speaking about presidential salaries, or somebody talking about diversity on campuses, or somebody talking about legacies and admissions, or somebody talking about development. And it's, so we have a panel, for instance, on money and transparency. But the person who's doing legacies with admissions, the person who's doing something on development, and somebody who's doing the presidential salaries, they never talk to one another. We have them on the same panel. We would like them to be connecting the dots. So it's going on from the 5th to the 7th of April. You're all welcome. You can come for two sessions, three sessions, 3 days, whatever you want. But we're getting nice registration. We have 5 people flying in from LMU. We have people coming in from Puerto Rico, from Texas, from around the country. So I want you to take one. There's enough copies for everybody here. That's it. I just want to start. I'm interested in listening to the 4 respondents, and then I'll respond to that. Thank you.
I tried to keep people from sitting at that back table there because I knew that there would be people who had to come late to me. Now the people coming late are going to have to like do the walk of shame all the way through. When you may be sipping your water and stuff like that, but a little bit later when we actually have dinner, if you want to come up and, you know, there will be some seats with our speaker, or maybe we'll press into that area. That reminds me that I didn't say a few thank yous. I just wanted to thank, obviously, my colleague Fran for all that we do together for the Hersher Institute and planning things together. When you're working with a lot of people in 2 emails and stuff like that, sometimes that's why there's little things like someone RSVP'd to her and it didn't get to me and we forgot and whatever. So a few of you that we kind of had left off until the last minute, our apologies, but there was room for all. But I want to thank our partnership with the provost and the president's office. So Hersher Institute did the expenses for the speaker and the books, and our very nice dinner is being provided by the president's office, and Rupendra and his assistant, Stephanie Poulos, has been great for helping with a lot of logistics, and Jody Walton, so I want to thank them a lot. So we came up with the thought of having a few of people from our community, based on the book, and from their perspective as a faculty, adjunct, administrator, and administrative staff, talk about a couple key important reactions and a couple key questions they want to focus on. So we're going to have Crystal Manning first, professor in the Department of Theology and Religious Studies, and then I'll introduce the others as well.
You guys got to come up front.
You guys, there was a rumor. Come on.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So thank you for being here. I want to start by saying this was a great book. When Brian asked me to do this, I was actually really busy writing a grant proposal, and so I put off reading it until last weekend, and then I thought, oh my gosh, I have to sit down and read this book. And I actually got through it very quickly. Once I sat down, it's very readable. And it's wide-ranging and very thought-provoking. So I hope it's going to lead to more long-term discussion here at Sacred Heart University. There are several points that I want to bring out that I thought were especially valuable for us here. The first was in terms of faculty ethics. What stood out for me was the focus on adjuncts and the caste system that we have. I really appreciate that you put this first before addressing things like race or gender or cheating. I think it cuts to the heart of the argument about how universities are good at teaching about ethics elsewhere, but not here. And also to how all of us find ways to rationalize our own privilege. I felt that your honesty about your own blindness at one time to the plight of the adjunct helped me to reflect on my blindness in that regard. And I remembered how some years ago, one of my courses somehow didn't have enough people to run, and at the last minute I was informed of that and was told I could either teach in the summer or we would bump an adjunct. And I chose to bump an adjunct because I didn't want to teach in the summer, and I had plans for the summer. That's changed, I think largely because I've become friends with some of our adjuncts. I commute to work with one of them. I am a personal friend of another whose son is friends with my daughter, and we live in the same neighborhood. And as a result of that friendship, I've come to see the issue differently. My friend Natalie, who is an adjunct here, sent me an email, I think it was last semester, and she was all worked up and she said, call me, and I called her, and she said, I got bumped. How could this happen? I depend on this income. I'm a single mother, and I felt awful. And I talked to her about how it could happen, but it really made me think about the issue. And I was thinking about the point that Father Keenan made about how faculty work isolates us from the plight of others and reduces solidarity. And I think there's some truth to that, but I also believe that people are going to rationalize their privilege even when they work in teams. So I'm not sure how much difference that makes. I think privilege itself limits solidarity. So that's the first point I want to make. In terms of student ethics, I don't have a clear sense of undergraduates behaving badly at SHU, to use the title of one of the chapters. So the chapter that resonated most with me in regards to cheating, to students, was the one on cheating. Plagiarism is very common at Sacred Heart. It has become ubiquitous in my experience, and I think that has a lot to do with the internet. I find myself overwhelmed in dealing with it. I cringe to read Father Keenan's comment about how most faculty don't report plagiarism, and then I thought, you know, I don't really report it that often either. Because it feels like too much work, the process of reporting it is complicated, it feels like I don't get rewarded for reporting it, it doesn't feel like the university really cares about the issue, and so you end up just calling the student in, you have a little discussion, and you let it go. So that chapter really resonated with me. Sacred Heart used to have a program called turnitin.com. That was really good, and it worked, and it caught stuff, and when we had that program, I actually did report people because it helped me do it. We don't have that program anymore. I don't know why. We have a program called Safe Assign that is useless in far as in my experience. It catches students copying each other's papers, but it doesn't catch any real plagiarism. So I think this is something to think about, maybe getting Turnitin.com back or some other program that maybe costs money but actually works would be something that I would recommend. A third point about the university generally, I was fascinated by the discussion of the historical perspective, how the tension between truth-seeking and the ministerial origins of the faculty, how that kind of conflicts with the college men and the frat boys and getting a degree because it's useful. And to think about how that has actually existed from the beginning, right? We tend to think of that as something new, something 20th century, and it's actually much older than that. I think that tension has some echoes in our recent election. And I think that maybe what's really changed in this tension between the elite and the common man and commodification is that commodification to me seems more open. It seems more, it seems like it has more legitimacy today. And I find that troubling. Which leads me to my last point, and that is that commodification is really the underlying ethical problem here. It seems like kind of a vicious cycle. Our university, like all universities, wants higher rankings. we want higher rankings in order to attract more students. In order to get higher rankings, we emphasize teaching. I mean, we emphasize research over teaching. I've been on rank and tenure for 4 years now, chaired it for a year, and that is very much at work. And I think it's something we need to look at. We hire more adjuncts so that we can let people do more research. Students cheat and act badly. We don't want to punish them too much, and that because that affects our bottom line. And so it, you know, it kind of goes round and round and round. And I think that some of our university leaders would acknowledge some of this, but there seem to be not enough actions to change it. You know, as a faculty member, it seems like there are lots of decisions that happen here at Sacred Heart that are all about commodity, like slick new buildings and golf courses and things like that. It's all about branding and all about image. But I was also encouraged to read a very thoughtful quote from President Petillo on page 188 of this book, reflecting more critically on this issue. And I also want to say that President Petillo's email recently to the entire faculty about the Muslim ban and inviting people to come to the chapel to be in solidarity with people from another culture was amazing and surprising, and I was really moved by that. And it made me feel hopeful about the willingness at this university to take some steps towards ethics. So those are my comments. I'll raise a couple of questions because Brian asked me to. Number one, I would like to know more about problems with student behavior at Sacred Heart. We have fraternities, we have football games. Do they behave badly? I have no idea. So I would love to hear about people's thoughts on that. And then secondly, my question is, how can we create respectful discussions and real learning about diversity without silencing free speech? I found it striking that in this book, you cited studies showing students are less interested in diversity the longer they are at college. And I couldn't help wondering if part of that wasn't kind of a backlash against, you know, the perception that, oh, you're supposed to think about diversity all the time, and, you know, microaggressions and all this other stuff. And so I'm wondering how can we walk that line? How can we talk about this in a real way that's also open? So those are my two questions. Thank you.
Do you want to come and get a seat up here with us?
Yeah, come on.
Yeah, we just didn't want it to run.
I know, I understand. Yeah.
Come on.
The room did not lend itself for our liquors. So next I had lined up an adjunct to speak. I think we have about five or six adjunct faculty as well as some clinical track faculty in the room. And so I had Chris Payone from the philosophy department, and he said he got the flu or something today and just felt it would not be good for being here for others. So he sent a brief audio response, which I can play now. So this is going to be very helpful.
Hello. I'm deeply honored and humbled to have an opportunity to speak to you today about Father Keenan's stimulating book on a university without ethics. I apologize that I'm not able to be there in person. Let me begin by making an observation. There, it seems to me, are two kinds of adjuncts at the American University. On the one hand are the adjuncts who come from the business and professional world with a certain set of experience and full-time employment there. They join the university to teach students from their experiences, but they really don't need the paycheck. I'll give you an example. My father-in-law is a corporate attorney. He teaches every spring 18 law students, pass-fail, about venture capitalism. so he doesn't need the paycheck. I'm not sure what he got out of it. I guess his third wife, but that's a different relation. On the other hand, there are adjuncts like me. We who have terminal degrees, like PhDs, who, finishing our programs, are unable to secure tenure stream employment, and so cobble together part-time employment at multiple universities for our jobs. The compensation is not commensurate with the work. I think Father Keenan has demonstrated that in his book quite clearly. And we're justifiably morally outraged at that situation. But it strikes me that moral outrage really only gets us so far. We can spend energy on it, but that doesn't make unlivable conditions livable. And that's what I think our goal should be. The solution that Father Keenan offers is to first begin with recognition and collegiality. I'm happy to report that I think, at least in my experiences at Sacred Heart, we do a reasonably good job at this. For example, in philosophy, theology, and religious studies, the former chair Brian Stiltner and the current chair Chris Kelly have both made quite a deal of efforts to make sure that we who are adjuncts get the courses that we need that fit our schedule and fit our teaching expertise. We're treated like colleagues there, whether we're adjuncts or faculty stream, tenure stream faculty. Likewise, at the School of Arts and Sciences, Dean Cowton has a spring soiree in appreciation of adjuncts, and this is good. We get to meet adjuncts in other departments, as well as our tenure stream faculty colleagues. What's the next step? I'd like to offer this. We should be encouraged by the collegiality, but not yet satisfied. We should all agree that the current situation is not necessary, that there are other possibilities. We don't have to exploit adjunct labor. Some of those possibilities are occurring at other peer institutions. For example, at Fairfield University, they have what are called professors of the practice, full-time teachers. Likewise, at another Catholic institution, the University of Dayton in Ohio, they have what are called master teachers. Both of these kinds of employment are full-time. And I think if we agree that we might have to work hard and experiment and try new things, but if we agree that the ultimate solution is no longer to have adjuncts, then I think we're on the right path. I hope that my comments here will help stimulate a discussion on how to address adjunct problems and ultimately cure them.
So next we're going to have Dean Patricia Walker from the College of Health Professions.
Hello, Brian told me to be brief and I promise I'm gonna do that. It's interesting that I have probably some of the same three things probably touched me that I think that Crystal probably mentioned in her presentation. And the first of which, when you start off in that first chapter, you start talking about the fiefdoms of the old university, how those fiefdoms have basically translated into silos, the silos that we now have. And then, maybe unique to universities, the silos are kind of, we layer them horizontally now with this caste system. And it's based on a lot of different things. And certainly it's based on race and gender, probably foremost. But then we added a little spin to it that for the university, so that now we've got the full-time faculty versus the part-time faculty, the tenure track and tenure faculty versus the term and the clinical faculty, the faculty administrators versus the staff. And it's always amazing to me how we spend so little time thinking of or speaking about the staff at this university based on the load we put on their shoulders and the expectations we have for them to frankly make this university successful. You wouldn't know that they existed most times here in terms of the conversations that we have, and they work very hard and very committed and do a lot for us that we couldn't do for ourselves. And then maybe, and then probably the idea too that we are so all complicit in it. We only worry about social justice when it comes to our group. So I want social justice for the black administrators. If I can find some more of them, I'm standing for that group. But you know, that's a count then. I mean, I'm only worried about me, and I'm only worried about my group. That I'm not incensed by how we treat our part-time faculty and our adjuncts. If I'm not concerned about how we treat our staff, then as a male, white male administrator, I don't care what happens to the black female faculty member. Then what, you know, where am I at? What am I doing here? And then probably the next one, that students behaving badly. Who was it said they hadn't seen any crystal? I seen a lot. I'm embroiled in a situation right now about students. So I would expand it. I'd say undergraduate and graduate students behaving badly, because when you put graduate students full-time cohorts into the same kind of situation that you would find undergraduate students, they act amazingly the same way. And so that when you talk about the bullying, now especially now the cyberbullying that we've got at the university level is tremendous. It's outrageous. I'm just, and I've been around the block a few times, I'm just shocked sometimes at the language that students are using to refer to their faculty, to refer to their fellow students. And I'm thinking these are intelligent adults who pay a lot to be here and they're acting this way, and why is that? I mean, where did that even come from? So they have these cyberbullying, these cliques. And as you talked about, it goes hand in hand with the existence of, you know, students wanting to be part of a group that has status. Boy, doesn't that sound familiar? You know, for the faculty. We want to be part of that group that has status. And so you aren't part of the group, you're marginalized, you're an outsider, you're sometimes victimized, as I'm seeing these students, victimizing each other. And it's disappointing. It's disappointing at this point in time. And so, you know, when we create these additional silos, and we track students, they're so similar to each other, and not to offend anybody, but I always call it kind of that Long Island effect. You know, when I've got all these students, and they're all kind of looking like, sounding like, thinking alike, and there's no diversity in the room, there's no diversity in some of the groups and organizations, how is that helping us? I mean, that's just making it, I think it makes it worse in terms of building these silos. So it can possibly be helping us in terms of our, what we say is our goal, in terms of having more diversity at the university. The stakes are high inside and outside the classroom for students. They are stressed to the max, and we're the ones who are stressing them, and they stress themselves, and their parents are stressing them. And they come here between that competition and the pressure to succeed, and understanding that somebody's making a big commitment in terms of money for them to be here. I guess I can see why they're ending up, some of them ended up cheating. I don't agree with it, I don't, you know, certainly condone it, but I can certainly sometimes understand it. That is kind of like the inevitable result of all the pressure that these students are under. And then probably finally, I'd like to also speak to that idea of commodification. When you talked about the core mission is compromised for the bottom line and for us to achieve our greater market share. Sacred Heart is the model. It's one of the models for that. I think about when we talked about the mission of Bishop Curtis, his vision for the university of trying to help people on that side of the street in Bridgeport have a better life, have an education that's going to lead them to a better life. And as a person who grew up on the west side of Chicago, I went to the state school as a commuter. It was my mother's dream that I would get an education, because she knew that's how Pat was going to succeed in life. And you don't do anything else until you get that education, and that's going to open the doors for you. And we promised those students across the street, Bishop Curtis promised them that, and we have just, I don't know, turned our backs on it. to do what we had to do. I understand why we had to do it, but we did what we had to do. But it didn't do anything, I don't think, in terms of our moving towards that mission to achieving what we thought was the goal was, to try to equal that playing field, to give people a hand up, to let them get out of the damn ghetto and have a good life, to support their families, just the way all of us in this room wanted to do. So it's disappointing. You know, some days it's just disappointing to see us wanting to be the great university that we're capable of being, and maybe we've lost a little bit of sight as to what that meant if we define greatness in terms of our original mission to the university. I was sitting here the other day to, you know, think there's this commodification, thinking about decisions that I make based on the bottom line and that you know, getting that budget met. And, you know, I'm like, boy, can I afford to actually dismiss this student as much as they need to be dismissed today? Is that gonna impact that retention goal? And I gotta go tonight and pull out the book, take a look. Can I afford to lose one more student here today? Maybe that's great for the student. I'm having second thoughts. I always try to have second thoughts because I understand that when I dismiss a student, it's just impacted the lives of the family. It's a big step, and so we do probation, we do a lot of decisions in the college, and I delegate a lot of those. I don't delegate dismissal. The dismissal is on me. I want it every time I look at that file and look at that student and make that decision on each and every one because I know the impact it's going to have on them and their families. But at the end of the day, too, I got to look at the bottom line before I make that decision, too, of what it's going to do to my goal, to our enrollment, the things we have to do to help the university succeed. So I appreciate the read. I've been kind of like Horace and said, you know, I started a little slow on it, but I got to certain chapters that it was just jam-packed full of information that I thought was useful. That we need to have, frankly, be reflecting on every day. And I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. And last, well, can I have some perfect on the students? Are you still going to do a little?
I wasn't sure that I committed.
Oh, I wasn't. Well, you were going to get back to you. Well, Larry Wilk is Dean of Student Life.
Brian asked me last week, and I said, let me think about it. He never came back to me to get my answer, so I wasn't sure as I was sitting here if I was going to be the fourth or not. But in part, I'll kind of follow up a little bit on what Crystal and in particular Pat had to say. You know, Crystal kind of spoke about reading the early parts of the book and kind of really understanding it, being fascinated. And then she got to the student affairs side and wasn't quite sure what this was all about. And I was obviously a bit of the reverse. But I really was, in particular, taken by the chapter on the adjuncts, because I think it's a group that we just forget about a lot. Now, I know an awful lot of the full-time faculty, but the majority of them. I know some of the adjuncts have been here a while, but we just take them for granted. They come and go, and they teach a lot of sections. And just a little story, because it just literally happened yesterday. There's a guy, for those of you who don't know, my office is in the Holly Lounge. There's a guy that I've seen. Started seeing him a lot last semester, and almost every day this semester, an older gentleman, sitting, I call it the aircraft carrier that's in the hall there, and he's talking to students, and at first, last semester, I actually thought he was just an older student taking classes, but I've seen him almost every day this semester. So yesterday I went down and introduced myself to him, and it turns out he's an adjunct professor, amazingly, Bob, it's one of yours, he's in the arts and sciences, and he's a science professor. And he said, well, I teach a couple of courses, and a couple of my students had asked me for some extra help, so I would meet them here, because he doesn't have an office. So he meets them down there in the middle of the hall with all the other nonsense going on. And he said, as time went on, they would say to me, I have a couple of other friends who are in completely different science classes, struggling. Would you be willing to help them? And he's like, yeah, I'm just sitting here. And this guy, literally, I see him with about 10 different students a day. And I just said to him, talked to him yesterday, I said, I just want you to know, I'm amazed. I think you meet with more students a day than any of us on campus. And you're an adjunct. And didn't even know his name, didn't even realize he was a member of the faculty until yesterday. I kind of got a sense this semester that he was. But every day, he's just one student after another, just coming in and giving them help. And I think we underappreciate that group a lot. Crystal, students behaving badly? And given that Pat and me have been working on a few of them, yeah, they range from the 18-year-olds to the over 30-year-olds, right, Pat? So in all different topics, we tend to put them in buckets. And I know, Father, in the book, you talked about fraternities and sororities, Greek life, or athletes. And while we put them in buckets, it's percentage-wise, if we took the student population, if 20% of the students were behaving badly, 20% of the athletes are. 20% of the non-athletes are. 20% of the fraternity. You know, there's no real rhyme or reason. But it happens. You might not realize it as much maybe if you're a faculty member, because it doesn't happen as much on campus. We're dealing with a lot of it in the surrounding community. But from the ethical standpoint, do we discipline them? Yes, we discipline them. But you know, in student affairs too, we believe that we're educators. And I personally, and I know all of our staff, does not believe that just disciplining is doing our job. We need to educate them too. So it would be easy to dismiss students. It is the hardest thing that I do, and not because of a commodity or a retention number. It is very difficult to sit down with a family and a student and not help them first, not give them a chance to turn their life around, particularly the 18 and 19-year-olds. Someone who's a graduate student should know better. You know, someone who's 28, 29, 30 plus married, they should know better. But we're in the business of educating students and trying to get them to the finish line in a positive way. So, I really appreciated, obviously, some of the topics. You hit all of the isms, as it were, in the student affairs, from the minority to international students, to sexual assault, and all of those things. The one other point that I'll make is, while some of the comments that you made I see on a regular basis, but maybe don't necessarily notice it, the international students, and particularly your comment about, and we have obviously a growing population, of how many of them have a friend from a different country or from the United States. And I would say that is almost next to zero. They stick together, it's difficult. The internationals are probably not feeling as welcomed by our undergrads or our graduate US students. The US students don't kind of extend out to them. But even on the, and while those tend to be a lot of graduate students, if you look at the undergrad level, where maybe there's a lot more integration going on because of the resident halls, it's only to a point, and all you need to do is look in the dining hall and look at the tables. I think for a lot of our students, it goes back to our high school experiences too. The dining hall is a big thing in high school, who you sit with. It's like a gang mentality. We don't necessarily have a gang mentality here, but if you look at the tables and see who's sitting with who, you can kind of get a sense of what's out there. So. I mean, those are just, again, some comments. I wasn't sure that I was.
I'm glad you did.
Beginning.
That's awesome.
Thank
you, Larry.
Thank you.
So my function is to respond, and then that perhaps by my response to further open up so that there can be comments and questions. And we have a microphone so that questions can be asked. But this will take me about 5 minutes, maybe six. The first thing I want to address is adjunct faculty. That comes up in each of the four presenters. Everybody brings that up. And yes, Crystal, I did want that to be the first case, and I think it's very important that it is. I think it identifies the university, whether we're talking about commodification, whether we're talking about the way the faculty relates, how the administration looks on the adjunct faculty body and the rest. It's kind of like the wound. And it needs to be addressed. One thing that happened as I took over the, as I published my book, as I finished my book, I was made the director of the Jesuit Institute at Boston College. This is, I have a great budget. I mean, anybody who's faculty, you get something like this, it's like fabulous. But it's called the Jesuit Institute because the Jesuits gave a gift to the university to promote a center on faith and culture. And it has existed for 27 years now. And it's a catalyst for bringing faculty seminars together, interdisciplinary seminars. So we have a seminar on economic inequity, on mental health stigma and suffering, on a common home. We have one coming up on religion, politics, and power, and one on women, religion, and power. However, The very first seminar I started was, all these seminars were for tenure track and tenured faculty. I decided, as the new director, I'm going to write to 18 professors of the practice. We have at Boston College, we have 167 professors of the practice. So just to explain, the professors of the practice get standard contracts, they have promotion, they have merit increment. We're right now assessing two faculty to be made full professors of the practice. We have promotions to associate professors of the practice. So we've created, if you will, a stable type of environment in which there were set contracts that were for full-time and permanent adjuncts. And I invited them to form seminar. And the first 6 months, we would meet just once a month, but for drinks, dinner, and a discussion, was like a coming home weekend. They had known of one another, but never had the opportunity to meet one another, these 18 people who were in all different departments. And it became really great, and they kept working. So at the end of 6 months, they said, we want to read a book. And I said, well, what? They said, we want to read University Ethics. So that sheet that you have is a conference that's being hosted by 18 professors of the practice. I learned, instead of starting with full-time faculty, tenure or tenure track, that it was much better to start with the adjuncts. That they were much more deliberative because they knew how unethical the university was or how much ethics was needed at the university. We did, at the Society of Christian Ethics that Brian and I attend, we had last January, we meet in January. It was founded by people who gave us the Protestant work ethic. So we have our conferences in January. Just imagine that. It goes from 7 in the morning until 10 at night, Protestant work ethic. When the Catholics entered it, they formed a group called the Catholics and Those Who Want to Drink with Them. At the Society of Christian Ethics, I've been addressing the issue of university ethics for the past 4 years. But this past year, we had finally a panel. And it was a panel on adjunct faculty. It was a panel of 3 adjunct faculty from 3 universities talking about their experience. At a conference of 400, 18 people showed up. 16 of them were adjunct faculty. The tenure track faculty do not show up for matters about the adjunct faculty. Whence I begin with adjunct faculty. Because if we don't, they will be less. And this has to be something that on the agenda we change things. So that the fact that each of the 4 signaled that, I think is really great. It says something about Sacred Heart and really having an intentionality about this matter, but it is really important. I think that what Chris said was really rather significant about trying to stabilize it and look at other practices, whether it's what's at Dayton or whether it's at Fairfield or another place, to look at those practices and develop that. But let me just add one other point on this. We had to compare them to what I would call the tenure track faculty. We had a racial incident at Boston College, and we decided, myself and the provost, hosted a race panel a year ago, January. And there was a lot of tension on the university. We ended up having 450 people come to this event. Many faculty came. We had a seminar of tenure track faculty and these 18 who are involved in this conference, the University Ethics Conference. By the way, those 18 adjunct faculty named their seminar the Jesuit Essentials. So I had asked them afterwards, how many of the Jesuit Essentials attended the race panel? Every one of them had. I asked the tenure track faculty who are there so that they can learn from one another about interdisciplinarity so that they can go off for tenure, that they're more rooted in the university than just the department. Not a one went to the race panel. There's something that's happening right now in our formation of young scholars that the blinders focused on research and teaching are exclusive and that they're not engaging the whole university and their interest in the whole university is, excuse me, I'm going for tenure and that's it. There's something that we're doing nationally that really is darkening because we ended up doing this seminar for tenure track. We have now suspended it. They don't even have time for meeting with one another. So there's something to see
when you see how the adjunct faculty are, like with Larry, that case that you gave of that guy who was just sitting there to welcoming people, the freedom that an adjunct who is really in, you know, wondering about getting bumped, compared to the creation of the tenure track faculty we have today, something to look at. The second thing I wanted to say is about students behaving badly. So I'm a Jesuit, I live right near campus, so I hear them all the time. And Julie Rubin did, well, two great books that I read. Helen Lefkowitz's book was called Campus Life. That knocked the socks off of me. This is the University of Chicago. She writes it about 40 years ago. She lives still in Cambridge. And she basically makes the claim that we think that rowdyism started with the fraternities. No, the rowdyism started with the American Revolution. Once rich businessmen got rid of the British, they wanted their sons to have nice, you know, I graduated from Harvard on their door. They didn't care about Harvard, they cared about the diploma. And commodification was born with the American Revolution and with the American businessman who made sure that his son went there. There are problems, and Julie Rubin did a book to say that in 1890s, the Ivies made a decision that it would be better for faculty that we did not deal directly with our students' own formational lives. That we relegate that to a whole new arena called later student affairs. And if there's another bridge that we need to build at the university, it's between academic formation and student formation. So I invite my colleagues to go, say, at anywhere from 11 p.m. to 3 a.m. on a Thursday night, Friday morning, to where Jim works at the Church of St. Ignatius. Because then you see our students leaving, and some of them coming back from wherever they've gone. But you get an idea of what our students' personal lives are like. I think that Crystal says she doesn't know about what is happening to how badly our students are acting, and two people, Pat and Larry, get up to say they are, at a university like Sacred Heart, conveys that we as faculty don't know about the lives of our students right in, now with us. We're not talking about them as graduates or before they come to us, but while they're here. Who are we teaching in our classrooms? If we don't know that they were arrested, that they were in hospital, that they were having their stomach pumped, what are we teaching in our classroom? This question of the relationship between the student as a person and the student as what? As a commodifying payer. Actually, we're really a part of that commodification because we brokered them, their personal lives, out of our classroom. And we don't even know how to enter into their personal lives because now we have an ethic about what we can and cannot bring up in the classroom. We've created an atmosphere in which we can't address the social problems or the personal problems that students have because we've remanded that to another group who would love to talk to us. And I always hear from student affairs, they welcome faculty to be involved, but then faculty don't know how to do this. Building that bridge between student affairs and academic life is really crucial. And as a matter of fact, it's becoming much more of a real break in whatever semblance of a bridge ever existed. The third, commodification, and I think I'll just, let me just say something on race and gender, because that didn't really come up. Pat pointed to it, but a little bit further. It is true, you know, our students self-select, and the longer they're in a university, the more they're comfortable with their own ethnic or racial group. And we haven't figured out a way of allowing them to meet one another, in part because that, I think, goes back to the fact that we wouldn't know that they self-select, because we only meet them in the classroom. And I think that the issues of race are indicative of our understanding of our students. I believe that, for instance, on gender, that the most important ethical intrusion that happened at American universities was the group Take Back the Night. That when they started operating 55 years ago, they were really trying to bring ethics onto the campus. And the voices of women strike me as really important. 53% of all undergraduates at American universities are women. But the leadership of our universities don't mirror that at all. When we look at adjunct faculty, it's close to, I mean, it depends on where you are, but it's certainly up at about 60-65% of your adjunct faculty are women. There's an issue of gender here that's really related to issues of power. And that's, it's kind of interesting how all these things get corded off into separate areas that we don't know much data about. But I think that's, again, about the way the university is created and the way we wear blinders trying to work out our work, like our tenure-track faculty, and that's why I bring them up. I think that their blinders are even thicker and more narrow than the ones we wear. And if that's the case, we're going in the worse direction than in a better direction. So I think that the issues of race and gender, that we have to ask about race, do we really know our students and their private lives, or at least their personal lives? And how do we bring that to bear in the classroom? And I offer some best practices about how you discuss neuralgic issues. But I'm much more interested in this issue of gender. We have at the conference Ruth Simmons. She's a hero in my book. Obviously, if you've read the book, you can see that Ruth Simmons is the person I most admire in university life. So she has that great comment that when she went to the first meeting of all university Ivy University presidents, they asked her, how do you feel at that meeting being the first African-American president of a Ivy University? And also, you were a woman. And she said, uncomfortable. I thought that word said everything, uncomfortable. So I want to put out that race and gender are really there. And the last thing is commodification. Crystal, it's exactly that. I mean, it's all about commodification, but it's been with us. It's been with us. It's just much more aggressive than ever before. But I'd like to show that, as a matter of fact, you know, what Crystal was saying and what Pat was saying, what Chris and what Larry was saying, there's a certain way that we faculty have really bought into it, hook, line, and sinker, that our relationship with the adjunct faculty, our relationship with the students, our inability to know their personal lives and to be so focused, and our relationship with staff that was brought up by a number of people, our infamiliarity with our staff, these are really constitutive of the commodification problem. So as we expect administrators to respond, I think there's a certain way that as faculty we have to respond. Mm-hmm. I do want to finally close to acknowledge, though, that the way the university is going and its allocation of resources is not moving in the direction of faculty. The adjunct faculty is a symptom of the way that the bureaucratization of the university into a corporate entity is more and more apparent. So that the questions of advancement and development, the questions of how we deal with legacies and the rest, have become so much a part of the budget of the university that our own roles as faculty are really kind of more and more limited. And as the adjuncts will be the first to point out, that actually having tenure-track faculty is something that they're interested in, and I think we should be as well. So thank you. Now let's open up to questions and comments. So you just raise your hand, and then we'll open it up. And if there are a few hands, we'll take a few voices. And we're drinking in 27 minutes. I was assured this by Fran several times.
I was just going to quickly comment on what was saying, that we don't have Turnitin anymore, and we can't catch the students as easily. And the biology department has pitched in, and we're going to buy Turnitin, and we're going to use it. Then I was thinking about it, and I feel like we're the police, and we're supposed to be policing the students. And actually, Turnitin has gotten much more complicated in that it's now a teaching tool. So it not only catches the student, but then it has a teaching component to it, where you're teaching the student what plagiarism really is, you know, how do you avoid it. So it costs more. It's going to cost us $32,000, in fact, a year. But it's a very good tool. And because I just didn't like the feeling of having to be the police, you know.
Yeah, ethics is ultimately about being proactive, is the best movement in developing students and teaching them how to do that. And I know we all like to like think, oh, why did they learn this in high school? But that's just not.
If I could, just quickly, one of the things I tried to do in the chapter on cheating was, what is the underlying culture that promotes the practices that you want to have? I think that's really crucial. I don't think we really address the question of cheating. Before we start worrying about policies, if we think that it's rampant, we have to address it as an issue and why it's wrong. But it goes to an insight that I think that the question of ethics at the university is worse than better over the years, and that cheating is indicative of that. So until we try to talk, so it was a lot of fun that Harvard had their cheating scandal that happened the whole time I was writing the book. And they didn't successfully resolve it to the end when they finally acknowledged that they had to work on a culture, which they didn't want to take that because UVA was doing it already and they don't like imitating. So, I mean, and finally, but because they wanted to put in practices. You can't put in a practice like that, like turn it in, if there isn't some sort of underlying culture that supports approbation about things for cheating. And particularly, it's very hard for adjuncts because they know that they will be denounced by a student because the student understands that they're vulnerable in their contract. So the one party that knows how bad policing is the people who are most vulnerable.
Hi. First of all, I want to tell you how much I loved your book. It really made me so much more aware of issues that I hadn't really thought about. I teach in the College of Nursing and the graduate online program, and of course our profession has its own code of ethics, so I've always been highly focused on our profession's code, but not in terms of the university at large. And I feel like ever since I finished your book 3 weeks ago, every time I open up a paper, there's a story about something that's happened. You know, like if you've never had shoulder surgery, you don't know anybody who's had it, and then you have it, and you walk around, and you find everybody in a sling and Starbucks everywhere. So I find every day now I see something about this. And I'm wondering if you could speak to the issue of any particular ethical issues with respect to distance learning or online learning. One of the things that stands out is the challenge of getting to know your student who you're teaching, and also that distance creates certain types of permissible behaviors. Both ways it can go that don't always support the education process. It seems when you've got that cyberspace between you that there can be liberties that students feel they have in how they address you. And I would say the same could be true for faculty as well.
Thank you. I mean, this is a like when I finished the book, Crystal mentioned this, free speech at the university. I have nothing on free speech at the university. And people said, you should have more on free speech. I said, well, I don't have anything. So it's the same with distance learning. I have nothing on distance learning. So I'm interested in hearing about this. My natural thing would be that the questions of the use of the internet as ethical issues is really a field that's finally emerging at the Society of Christian Ethics. So this is ethicists who teach at any type of university that has that has some sort of program that's related to religious studies, or and it could be we have the Society of Jewish Ethics, the Society for the Study of Islamic Ethics, and the Society for Christian Ethics, and about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, we started having panels on internet ethics. So I think that that's going to be the link. But I mean, I put down your name to just follow up more in the future about the question of distance learning. So what I'm finding by going around is just how extensively we should be thinking of ethics rather than the agenda I established in the book. So thank you.
Sure.
Do anyone else, maybe, we could go on to different kinds of topics, or Fran from technology for some reason.
Yeah.
I was just maybe staying on this topic of distance learning, or
I have another question.
Okay, if any of you, like, that would also be a comment or question you had, maybe there's something you can...
I would just like to comment on distance learning and co-modification.
Perfect.
And how they're intertwined.
Yes.
And that here at Sacred Heart, we have a for-profit company running our online programs, and we are a not-for-profit university.
Right. I mean, these are, what you're doing is you're naming where things converge in the issue of commodification that are really disturbing. You know, about 10 years ago, 12 years ago, when the Chronicle of Higher Ed started writing about MOOCs, you know, they couldn't stop writing about MOOCs. And then they stopped writing about MOOCs. And then it's, you don't know whether they went underground or where did they go. But there's a certain way that distance learning really doesn't get the attention that it needs. But also, one has to ask, where is the need for it driving? And then who is nourishing that need? So I think you get an intersection there.
Just two other comments to extend the conversation. When you talked about bullying, parents bullying faculty. And that's a big problem, especially I think in the College of Health Professions and the College of Nursing because of the high stakes of it, and it's just something that probably as a university we need to have a discussion. Is there a solution to that, to have it not be? And then the other thing is student formation and getting involved in student formation. I think another conversation that faculty can have, that there's fallout from faculty to faculty when you do get involved in students' lives.
Right.
That you'll hear comments like, don't get too involved, or they're adult learners, they should know better, those kinds of things. So just...
I think the two issues you bring up are two issues that I think, you know, that point that I keep trying to make that I get from Wayne Meeks, making ethics means making community. I think that this is really rather important. So when I'm talking about ethics, I'm thinking, how do we feel better doing ethics? I think many of us as faculty would love to talk about best practices of dealing with parents. I mean, the parents that I'm dealing with, I run it's the only academic merit scholarship at Boston College. We have 65 students. They receive the full 4 years of the tuition remission. They pay for housing, and that's about it. And it's a great program. But the entitlement of parents today, you know, I have parents calling me and yelling at me if their child wasn't admitted into our program. I'll say, excuse me, do you know the difference between entitlement and merit? They'll say, no. And I say, well, this call is about entitlement, and our program's about merit, and that's why your daughter didn't get in. Hang on. But that's my experience. How do we collectively share with one another how do we deal with aggressive parents who are not diminishing because of the point of commodification? They feel that with these tuitions, they have a right to do that. But the people who can afford these tuitions are familiar with privilege. So these are all issues that are connected, but I do think we have to figure out, if we were reflecting ethically at a university, we could share from administrators who have to deal with them much more than we faculty do. I mean, as Larry and Pat were pointing out, we could learn a lot more. And on student formation, I agree. I think I'm not suggesting that all of a sudden people say, oh, share with me your sexual assault stories here in class. I think that would be a danger too, to go in the opposite extreme, to have, you know, student issues suddenly discussed. I just don't think that we've begun a process for knowing how we bring these questions to bear in the classroom. That's been because we've had a habit since 1890. That's a 120-year-long habit of us being isolated from the so we have to be very hesitant about how we're going to do that. But ethics is really about this culture that's mindful of a way, and trying to figure out constructive ways of building the university so it's not so siloed, so it's not so departmentalizable, but that, like this, a forum, an interdisciplinary forum, where people can talk about where they would like to learn some best practices. I would say dealing with parents and figuring out how to address issues in the classroom would be two starting points.
Okay, I'd like to speak to the issue of students. First of all, my undergraduate, you all know I teach computer science. My undergraduates don't like online courses, and they're the technology geeks of the world. They don't like it. They like being in a classroom with a teacher. So that's the first thing. I was really encouraged a couple of, probably 2 weeks ago, when I got something, an email that said how to deal with a distressed student from the counseling center. I think that email was sent to all faculty. I was really happy to receive that, because often we don't know where to go as faculty. And I would say I'm privileged to teach computer and information ethics. So my mission for 31 years has been to sensitize students to ethical issues. And we get a lot of those things. They get more comfortable. I say this is the place that you can put on any hat you want and discuss anything, and they do. And I think as faculty, we can recognize red flags. This week I had one student come to me because he was arrested over the weekend, and I had to reach out to Larry because another one of my students was kicked off campus, suspended for a week, and I said, well, what do I do about this? The student is supposed to take a test. What are my options, or how can I support you? So I had to reach out to figure out, and I've been here 31 years, and I didn't know, this was the first time I had ever heard about something like this, or anybody had ever reached out to me as a faculty member, and I said, well, I have to email Larry immediately, because I don't know what to do about this situation, and he was wonderful and got right back to me. But I think it's important, this dialogue. I mean, we want this dialogue. Faculty want to know how to help students. I've had students come to me and say, I haven't registered because I just don't have the money. I have to know who to go to. I have to know that I need to call Mike Bazone if it's a freshman, or financial aid, and say, can you help? This is a really good student. His father was just laid off. His mother is support. I mean, we need to know the directions, and I think whether it's emails like what to do with a distressed student, what to do with a student who's having financial troubles, who what's the path, who to go to, would be so helpful to us. I pass this to Jerry.
Hi, I'm Jerry Reed from the Sociology Department. One of the things that intrigued me about the book was, I think you're continually raising the question of how do we create and maintain a culture of ethics. And as I read your book, the answer I think that I was reading in the book was that it's community which is necessary to create a culture of ethics. And just taking that a step further, it seems to me that you're defining community in this context as a place where there is communication, where there is shared responsibility and decision making. And so I wonder if you would comment on this, on these two notions of a culture of ethics, creating and maintaining a culture of ethics, and community, and the connection between those two.
So again, my own experience, like at the Jesuit Institute, I've decided that even though it's supposed to be faith and culture, that we're setting up two other seminars. We're setting up a seminar for administrative assistants across the university. It'll be the first time that they will be invited into the Jesuit Institute in the 27 years we've existed. But just so that, and we thought of maybe mixing it, but I think that they would feel much more comfortable if they were meeting one another across the university as leading staff people, that they could talk about the nature of the university. And then the second seminar, after we start that one, we're doing one with grounds, dining services, and housekeeping. And again, we'll have them working with one another. We don't foresee people feeling comfortable to sit at the same table from these different groups yet. But we do feel that we need to build up some sense of solidarity among them in their different cohorts, so that, as what we did with the professors of the practice, they now feel a sense of ownership in their program, and now they're hosting this university ethics, and there's a coming of age collectively of them. We don't know what the administrative assistants will do, nor do we know what the staff will do. But we're also watching the faculty who are on four other seminars looking at this one group that has become so productive that they're actually like a catalyst for the other four groups. So I'm just using one image that I have. That is, just as you said, it's really about building community. The more we fortify our relations with one another, the more we can see it important for the university to fortify relations in the other different groups first. I think then we can have more integrated discussions. But until we empower other groups on the campus, they're going to be shy coming to a seminar that's dominated by tenured faculty or by administrators. I mean, how many faculty feel comfortable going to administrators, that's predominantly administrators? So how many administrators feel comfortable going to that? So I do think that it's important for us to keep building ways that we're connected. And I do think that both the university and the vocation of the professor conspire against it. So it's not easy. I think Christmas parties are enormously important. I think acknowledging promotions. If we had events at universities where people's promotions were acknowledged across the board, whether they're in grounds, whether they're in administrative assistants, whether they're administrators, if we did some sort of way of showing that we are a university rather than a set of departments, we're in a much stronger place.
I just heard the pop of
it. You have 91 minutes.
We have 91 minutes, so
I have the clock right here.
Anyone after?
I was reading about the caste system, and you're talking about our employees in the university earning actually less than the federal poverty level, right? But I'm actually talking about similar situation for our students. I know that the for-profit colleges take the brunt of it, but I'm pretty sure we're all guilty of it. Is that we are preparing students for jobs that doesn't pay enough, and we know that we're gonna offer these courses, we're gonna offer these majors, or offer these programs, or graduate programs that will get them $30,000-$40,000 a year job. They're gonna pay hundreds of thousand dollars with a lots of loans, and they will not be able to pay. Right. So this kind of, it can be discussed. What do you think about this kind of ethical problem?
So I teach a course called HIV, Brian mentioned it earlier, but I teach a course called HIV, AIDS, and Ethics. And I use it as a way of looking at the university while looking at a public health issue. And when we get to class, the students talk about class as happening anywhere but among themselves. And that's because I think that the working class students in the class are unable to speak and unable to talk about their experiences. We still have these tux and gown celebrations at the end of the year that are basically humiliating for about a third of our student population. And no one figures out a way to raise that up as an issue. But the one third of the students are going to be working that night, and two-thirds are going to be wearing tux and gowns. There's something not of a university, there's not a community, when you create an event, a major commencement event, that a third of your population can't participate in. So I think class is really indicative of, again, why we need to do community building, so that we can know. And when I bring up class, the students will say, this is the first time in my 4 years here that a professor has brought up class at our university, that affects me, and I'm happy to hear it. But they'll say that to me privately rather than publicly in the class. So these are things I think that we have to really attend to. Class is as deep as gender issues and race and sexuality issues on our campuses. I know you hear the blind going, so I think anyone else wants it? Because Crystal,
all right, we'll do the last two. We'll do Jim.
And there's a hand here too.
I'm going to make believe that none of you are here. I'm going to talk simply to Father for just a second. I enjoyed your book.
My undergraduates call me Jim, so just call me Jim.
All right, Jim. I'm a Jim as well. I'm the senior VP for Enrollment, Student Affairs, and Enrollment. Every time I turned your book as I got into it, I started to cringe a little bit. Because I understood deeply the criticism, which I, in some of your paragraphs within the book and some of the researchers that you quoted, this commodification piece, it's real. I represent a lot of it. But there's a reality to the work of myself and some others, and that is this no margin, no mission. Just in the Chronicle this week, it talked about 40% of schools, private schools, with 1,000 or fewer students are going to go by boards. Catholic College in Indiana has closed. Mount St. Mary's, that's in our athletic conference, is just hanging on. So I represent, and I think in your book, that I represent where one of my eyes is always looking outside. And the other eye is in here with the experience of our students in the classroom, outside the classroom. Pat talked about the mission with Bishop Curtis, like 27 years of understanding that. But don't know exactly how to combat it. We have students that leave us, many with financial issues, adjustment issues. The third of the folks you just mentioned who aren't able to go to the Tux and Gown event and don't know how to address it. So the no margin, no mission thing often gets in front of the decision making that myself and some other administrators need to make, and I'm actually going to try to go to your conference, because I've been to a fair number, just to understand how to deal with these very difficult, sensitive, and at times, issues that have different perspectives, because some of us are looking at it from this lens and others from another. And I'll close with this. I think that I appreciate greatly your suggestion, and the folks that spoke talked about it, and the bridge between student affairs and academic affairs. God knows, Larry and myself, a lot of the folks in my division, we go to many of our conferences, and this is a common discussion point. And like, you're not sure what to do with the kid, we don't know what to do always in terms of how to follow up or approach our faculty, be they tenure adjunct. The silos, rather, that you were referring to, by the way, we have them too. So I thank you for the time in your book. I look forward maybe to talking about this margin of mission situation that I don't think is going away.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think the two things to say to that I really love what you were saying. One, in the book, I go after students, but not student affairs. Because I always go to student affairs for advice. I have 65 fairly talented students who have fairly talented problems. And I'm constantly going to student affairs. And I think what Fran said earlier is really rather crucial. I think a lot of us as faculty, the more we know more about student affairs, the better we are. So this bridge building, I think, is really important. I think analogous, it struck me as was behind some things he was saying. The one group that I find is most ethically alert to these issues is development. That may seem counterintuitive, but as a matter of fact, development are people who've had training in business ethics. And they're a little more attentive to what professional ethics is required because they've been burnt by all sorts of gift-giving and rest. And so when I talk to development people about it, it's like talking to student affairs. They've been dealing with these ethical issues for a while, and they kind of welcome this discourse. I think getting faculty and administrators on board is different than getting student affairs personnel and development. They seem to be already primed at the pump. He had his hand up. I don't know if you're not interested.
So,
well, it's really time to eat, but
or drink.
I just want to real quick. It,
your very end of your book, you mentioned about if you were university president, you would set up a committee. And you said you would hopefully have input from all the different strata of the university, students, undergrads, graduate, adjuncts, et cetera, all the way up to board of trustees. And I would like to hear more about, if you were university president, how would you convince the board of trustees to break the commodification mentality?
Yes.
Maybe you need wine for that one.
No, I think that in many, more and more, I know we think that the Board of Trustees has a great a deal of authority, but as a matter of fact, the president really allows or doesn't the Board of Trustees to exercise their authority. And in many, many universities, you see more and more that the Board of Trustees knows about the university to the extent that the president wants them to know about the university. I think that's a reality that has to be acknowledged. I mean, I can be at a place where somebody says, we want to give this book to all the members of the Board of Trustees. And I find out that the book can't go to them because the president decides what goes to the Board of Trustee members. So they never read the book because they can't get to them. There's a certain way that what I was saying about silos, you know, the ultimate silo is really the president's office and the Board of Trustees. And silos work for not communicating and for controlling communications. This is a university. It's about sharing knowledge. That's why we started universities, was to share knowledge. If there's a way that at the highest level that there's inhibiting the trustees from understanding better the university, then there's a certain way that we have to ask, what is the ethos of that connection? So I do think that when I see Board of Trustee members, I give them a copy of my book. I think, yeah, I know they could buy it, but I think they should have it. So I think that if you can get it to your Board of Trustee members, try it. I hope you succeed.
Thank you.
Thank you again, and thank you for all those comments. So let's have a round of applause for Jim.
As Jim is coming and Brian coming, please come to this. We really want people from different backgrounds to come and to see how other universities are trying to wrestle with this. So just sign up online. She has plenty of information.